WYFF News 4, live local breaking news at 6.
He just shot my son and kept shooting and shooting and shooting. And he would not stop until there wasn't no more bullets in the gun.
She saw her own son shot to death after what investigators are calling a neighbor squabble.
And a house fire has taken the lives of two women and badly injured a baby in Union County. Good evening. Welcome. I'm Michael Cogburn.
And I'm Carol Goldsmith. But first, a man who started his own neighborhood crime watch in Waterloo is now accused of shooting an unarmed neighbor to death last night in plain view.
And before the shooting, investigators say the suspect, Juan Burns, left threatening messages for the victim and his family. News 4's Angela Rodriguez joins us live and local outside the Lawrence County Jail tonight. Angela, you talked to the victim's mom and the neighbors, right?
And they described this suspect as a wannabe robocop. In fact, we learned today that deputies were called to this Waterloo neighborhood just last week because the man was seen pointing a gun with a laser. But they tell us that things got way out of control yesterday. They say there were bodies outlined in chalk in front of his house. They say he left a note at the victim's mother's house along with a broken mirror, a candle, and even nails. And just hours later, that woman says she watched her son die in her arms.
Well, when he was born, he had the sky blue eyes, so we just always called him Blue, and I called him my Blue Boy.
Sheila Cathcart says her son Blue's murder was premeditated by a man who started his very own neighborhood crime watch.
He's definitely put a lot of thought into.
It started with bodies outlined in chalk on Skillet Road yesterday. The color blue, like the name of the victim. The ominous figures found in the shadow of a sign meant to ward off crime.
He's harassed just about everybody on this block.
Cathcart says Juan Burns engaged her son Blue in the middle of the street, but his words were no match for the gun investigators say Burns pulled out.
He had holes all over his body where that man just opened fire.
Investigators say before the squabble, there were more signs of trouble.
He threw all these nails out in our driveway.
And a threatening note that warned, "Turn and burn, Blue and Company. Think carefully." Investigators say the crime watch was not formally organized, nothing official. The so-called leader is now an inmate, charged with murder and attempted murder.
I would just like to know why.
She held her son as he took his first breath and his last, and now she promises to fight for justice as long as she has a pulse.
He just shot my son and kept shooting and shooting and shooting. And he would not stop until there wasn't no more bullets in the gun.
The victim, Charles Blue Lyons III, leaves behind 8 children. The suspect in this case, Juan Burns, appeared in bond court just about an hour ago. That bond was denied, and the only question that we heard from him was about how he could find an attorney. We checked, and by the way, he did not have a record in South Carolina before yesterday. Angela Rodriguez, WYFF News 4, live tonight in Lawrence County.
Angela, thank you. The trial is underway for a Greenville man accused of dismembering a woman 4 years ago. Jury selection for Clarence Jenkins' murder trial started this morning. Now, you may recall, he and his wife, Carmen, were arrested after police found body parts left in plastic bags outside two homes on April 7, 2008. Investigators say they found evidence in the couple's home that they killed Nicole Harris and used pruning shears to cut up her body. Investigators said Harris was a random victim and that the couple used her body parts to threaten and extort money from another person. During previous hearings over the year, it was revealed that Clarence Jenkins had met Harris at a job placement agency a short time before Harris's death. Prosecutors originally said they wanted to seek the death penalty against Clarence Jenkins, but now they no longer plan to. Mrs. Jenkins pleaded guilty in the case about 2 weeks ago and was sentenced to 50 years in prison. She is expected to testify against her husband.
Spartanburg County deputies tonight want to find the person who shot a convenience store clerk overnight. This happened around 2:15 this morning at the Circle K store on Blackstock Road in Moore. Investigators say a man came in with a gun, shot the clerk in both shoulders, and then got away with some cash. The clerk soon called 911. He was taken to Spartanburg Regional Medical Center, expected to be okay. But the shooter is still on the loose tonight, and if you can help authorities find that shooter, call Crime Stoppers. You don't have to give your name. They're at 1-888-CRIME-SC.
A wreck in Pickens County killed one driver and injured another today. Troopers said a Ford minivan headed north on Highway 183 crossed the center line and collided with a Chrysler minivan in a southbound lane. All of this happened at about 12:30 this afternoon. The driver of the Ford died at the scene. The other driver was taken to Greenville Memorial with injuries. The Highway Patrol is investigating a wreck that killed a woman in Anderson County over the weekend. That wreck happened Saturday on Crestview Road near Midway Road. The coroner says 31-year-old Eileen Peters died when her car collided with a van, which was headed in the opposite direction. Troopers say a toddler and a baby were in the back seat of the car. They were treated at the hospital and have been released. The driver of the van was also injured. No word on their condition.
An Anderson County man is being called a hero for his bravery tonight. Tony Dwyer was given the Highway Patrol Hero Award today. Troopers say Dwyer was driving on Hill House Road in Anderson County last December when he saw a wrecked vehicle that had crashed into a tree and had caught fire. Troopers say Dwyer pulled the driver, Emily Hendricks, out of that car just moments before the car burst entirely into flames. Four upstate law officers are going to be honored for pulling a state trooper out of his burning patrol car. Three Easley officers and a Pickens County Sheriff's deputy came to the rescue. You may remember this. This was the night Lance Corporal Christopher Bratcher crashed his car in Pickens County. It happened last month. Authorities say Bratcher lost control as he was chasing someone on a motorcycle. He was trapped in that burning car, and those officers pulled him out to safety. Bratcher is seriously injured, remains in the hospital tonight. The officers who saved him are being honored during the Easley City Council meeting at 7 o'clock tonight.
Investigators say a one-year-old baby was badly burned, and two people died after being burned beyond recognition after a fire in Union County.
Investigators say they believe the baby's grandmother and great-grandmother died in the fire. It'll take an autopsy to confirm their identities. News 4's Myra Ruiz has more tonight from Union County. Myra.
Investigators say four generations of one family lived in this home and three were home at the time the fire broke out. A neighbor called 911 after spotting the smoke. Investigators say he actually tried to force his way into the house. He was successful at doing that, grabbed the baby, and then had to get out.
The house was filled with smoke. Baby was laying in the doorway crying. He could not. He said once the door, he opened the door, it fed the flames oxygen. And pretty much got so inflamed that he could not get any closer.
Firefighters found two bodies inside this house. They could not identify them. They were told that they were burned beyond recognition, but they are believed to be the grandmother and great-grandmother of the baby girl who was rescued. Now, the baby girl has been taken to the Augusta Burn Center with serious burns, we are told. We do not have an update on her condition, but meantime, investigators with the ATF, SLED, Union County Sheriff's Office are all working to figure out what happened, why this fire was so bad, and what caused it to break out. At this point, they have not found any sign of a smoke detector, and they're still looking for answers in this case.
Myra Ruiz reporting for us from Union tonight. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission will have a meeting tonight to discuss safety at the Oconee Nuclear Station. The plant is operated by Duke Energy and is located near Seneca. The NRC says the plant met all of its safety objectives last year, but it will be subject to more oversight because of a finding on December 6th. That was related to a failure to adequately maintain the plant's standby shutdown systems. Tonight's meeting comes just days after a reactor shut down at the station. Authorities say a very small leak in a non-radioactive cooling system forced engineers to power down one of the three reactors for repairs. They say the leak was contained. There was no threat to the public, they say, and the shutdown was just a precaution. The NRC will hold its meeting at 6:30 tonight at the Oconee World of Energy in Seneca. The NRC will make a presentation, then open the session up to questions from the audience.
Michelin calls this the company's biggest manufacturing news in more than 15 years. The tire maker will officially announce it tomorrow. But News 4's Gabrielle Komorowski is in the know tonight, and she found this announcement will include a huge economic boost for a certain upstate county.
Michelin officials are remaining very tight-lipped about what will be revealed Tuesday morning, only saying the announcement will impact Anderson and Lexington counties. In Anderson County alone, Michelin employs 700 people at its two plants in Sandy Springs and on Michelin Boulevard. The number of employees may soon increase. Last week, the Anderson County Council approved what was known as Project Cougar, an incentive agreement for Michelin that includes tax breaks and waived fees. The agreement includes an investment of between $150 million and $1 billion and creation of between 150 and 300 jobs.
We're ready to move forward with them, they've got their paperwork in line. We just don't know what it is, and we've got our paperwork in line.
Anderson County Councilman Francis Crowder doesn't yet know which of the county's two plants will be affected. He does know that this is a big deal.
And we're thankful to have two major facilities and hopefully two major facilities after tomorrow morning.
Gabrielle Komorowski, WYFF News.
Yes, she is. Now, stay tuned for this. Michelin's going to make that announcement at 10 in the morning at the company headquarters in Greenville. Governor Nikki Haley, Senator Lindsey Graham, and officials from Anderson and Lexington counties are scheduled to attend. There is now more affordable housing for senior citizens in Greenville. A ribbon cutting was held for Bethel Place Apartments this afternoon. The three duplexes are on Indell Street on Greenville's west side.
Each home is 936 square feet and has two bedrooms and one bath. And renting one will cost $395 a month. The complex was developed by Homes of Hope, and the city invested $65,000 in the project. Well, hurricane season is right around the corner, and there's already a new prediction for what it's going to be like.
Chief Meteorologist John Sesswich was at the National Hurricane Conference in Orlando just a couple of weeks ago. What did you find out this year, Ruth?
Got the inside scoop.
There you go.
Yeah,
of course you do.
Talking to a lot of the hurricane forecasters down there in Orlando, and they're thinking that a couple of factors may come into play to where this is going to be a non-active hurricane season.
Right.
Oh, really?
Yeah, how's that? And here's the reasoning why. So a below normal season, now that just means just the numbers. Now, of course, just don't get all caught up in all the numbers because of the fact that if it just takes one, remember Hurricane Andrew in 1992, which hit just south of Miami in the Homestead area at Category 5. That was the A, first storm of the year, and pretty much it for the rest of the hurricane season. So it just takes one hurricane. But the water temperatures in the tropical Atlantic are a little bit cooler than normal, especially from last year, so that's good news. Remember, a hurricane to form needs water temperature of at least 80 degrees or greater. And it looks like we're going now from the La Nina pattern into a neutral pattern, and a lot of the hurricane forecasters were hinting at that we may be going into a weak to moderate El Nino conditions. And if that does develop, that means a very strong westerly flow, and that will just wind shear, just cut out all the tropical storms and hurricanes and keep them and just tear them up out there in the Atlantic, which is great news. So if an El Nino does develop, that means really a non-hurricane season for us, and that is great news. So we'll keep you updated. Hurricane season doesn't officially begin until June 1st, and it usually doesn't peak until the end of August and into early September, so we're looking pretty good. Let's take a look at the radar. Live Super Doppler 4HD, nice and quiet, should remain that way, not just tonight, for quite a while. How about your headlines as far as the weather goes? This is for the next several days. Tomorrow afternoon, windy conditions will develop, especially in the mountains, and even quite breezy conditions in the upstate and northeastern Georgia. Then tomorrow night and Wednesday night, much colder temperatures across the area. Freeze watch for parts of the mountains, and I'll talk more about that in just a second. And then Wednesday night, maybe even the coldest of the nights, and lighter winds, meaning a better chance for frost developing Wednesday night into Thursday morning, not just in the mountains, but possibly even in the upstate and northeastern Georgia. So we'll keep you updated on that. As we head toward the weekend, dry conditions, but a warming trend actually starts on Friday. Outside right now, it's just beautiful, as you can see, mainly in the 70s in northeastern Georgia, upper 70s in Danielsville, and also in Elberton, upper 60s in Clayton right now, 69 degrees. North Carolina, also temperatures pleasant across the area with very low humidity levels. Right now, 71 in Asheville, 69 degrees in Hendersonville, 74 degrees currently in Rutherford. In the upstate, also nice and mild temperatures in the 70s across the area, as you can see. Warm spot downtown Greenville at 78 degrees, 77 in Newberry, 77 in Abbeville, Anderson, Walhalla, and in Pickens. Here's what it looks like as far as humidity levels. Extremely low, only 12% humidity right now in downtown Greenville. There is definitely a fire danger. I would ban all outdoor burning for at least tomorrow afternoon and possibly even the next day, because humidity levels are going to remain very low. And with low humidity levels and this breeze continuing from 15 to 20 miles per hour and gusty from time to time, that's going to continue to dry out the vegetation. Temperature-wise, 79 degrees regionally in Columbia, also in Augusta. There's the freeze watch, which starts for basically most of the mountains of North Carolina, it looks like, except for, it looks like Clay and Cherokee counties, but they could be included by tomorrow night. Freeze watch for late tomorrow night and into Wednesday morning. Then probably more watches, warnings, and advisories Wednesday night into Thursday morning. So tomorrow morning, cool conditions in the upstate, 56 degrees at 9 o'clock. Sunny skies, 71 at noon. The breeze picks up out of the west at 10 to 20 miles per hour and gusty high temperature 76. For the mountains, light to maybe breezy conditions in the morning, then strong winds in the afternoon. Very windy conditions, mostly sunny skies and cool with those strong winds. High temperature 64 degrees after we start off at 41 degrees. 4 day plus looks like this. Very cool conditions on Wednesday and Thursday during the day. Warming trend, as I mentioned, starts on Friday, continues through the weekend and into early next week. Back in the 80s by the end of the weekend. Yes. I'm liking that.
65 and an 84 on the same timeline. It's pretty weird.
Wow.
Right there.
John, that time of year. Thanks, John.